It was a nothing story, a tabloid tale involving a member of the British royal family, but its publication in late 2005 and the suspicion that the reporter got the story by hacking into voicemail messages on the subject's mobile phone started an investigation that by 2011 laid bare a political scandal that reached into multiple British institutions and painted a picture of a news organization so powerful that those institutions, including Parliament, police, and the rest of the British news media, dared not take it on. The de facto investigation wasn't even conducted by the London Metropolitan Police Force. It was primarily the work of a newspaper, The Guardian, and, for the most part, one reporter, Nick Davis. Davis has just published a book on the story, Hack Attack: How the Truth Caught Up with Rupert Murdoch. What starts as a probe into the criminal culture at British tabloids owned by Murdoch's News Corporation ultimately lifts the veil on the shadowy end of government, the cozy relationship between successive prime ministers at 10 Downing Street and a media baron skilled at acquiring assets, wealth, and political power. I sat down with Nick Davis in London to discuss the story, the power of fear, and the future of the Murdoch media empire, which lies disgraced, but by no means defeated. Nick Davis, thanks for joining us here at the Listening Post today.
Okay.
In your epilogue, you write that we need to shake ourselves free of this illusion that because we won a really important battle, we won a war, that by exposing some secret machinations, we stopped the machinations occurring. In truth, very little has changed. Since when have journalists on book tours been so modest about their accomplishments?
No, that's actually the reality about being a writer or a journalist, is that you have this fantasy that if you write about a bad thing, the bad thing will stop. Whereas actually what happens, and this is a classic example, the phone hacking scandal, you write about the bad thing, the people who are responsible get extremely angry and do a lot of running around shouting, and then they carry on. So in this particular case, we've probably stopped the hacking of phones. I would think that criminal activity in British national newspaper offices has fallen from rather a high level to zero. But that's about all we've achieved. So I just didn't want people to kid themselves that we'd actually changed what's really important about the story, which is about Rupert Murdoch's abuse of power, his political power, his ability to frighten the police, his ability to frighten all sorts of people in the power elite. So we might have stopped a bit of crime going on in newspapers, but that's it.
I've said to people that I think this is the biggest scandal, political scandal in modern British history. The thing about this one was that it reached into so many of these British institutions.
Exactly.
It was so pervasive.
Yeah.
So do you see it the same way as I do?
It's a quite extraordinary story from very, very small origins. Precisely as you say, it reaches into so many different parts. And what that reflects is the way in which Rupert Murdoch's power reaches into so many different parts. So as soon as you start looking at the crime, then you say, well, how come they got away with that crime? So in a small way, you look at the press regulator. So they did nothing about it. Then you look at the police. They did nothing about it. And then the next thing is you look into the most important area, which is government. A long history of our elected governments, these supposedly democratic governments, allowing Rupert Murdoch and his network to influence them in a way that ordinary voters have no chance of exercising that kind of an influence. And you take that lovely little idea we came up with once upon a time about one man or woman, one vote, this government works for us, and you put it in the waste bin because the media mogul has come in. He's the guy with the influence.
That influence starts with the newspapers Rupert Murdoch controls, Britain's biggest daily tabloid, its best-selling weekly tabloid, plus The Times and The Sunday Times. That amounts to roughly 4 out of 10 papers sold in the UK. Then there's Sky TV, the country's most profitable broadcaster, and its news, sports, and entertainment channels. The phone hacking scandal occurred mostly at the now-defunct News of the World, where that story about the royal family first appeared in 2005. The police investigation that followed was limited but resulted in 2 convictions, private investigator Glenn Mulcair and the paper's royal correspondent Clive Goodman, both of whom did jail time. The paper and its parent company, News International, went into cover-up mode, saying that Goodman was just one rogue reporter. By 2011, its cover-up blown, News International produced an unreserved apology to the thousands of victims of hacking, including senior cabinet ministers, celebrities, football players, even their agents. The company was forced to abandon its rogue reporter defense as the evidence mounted. Evidence uncovered, for the most part, by Nick Davis at The Guardian. The rest of the British news media were conspicuously silent on the story. Few parliamentarians were willing to raise it, even some who had had their own phones hacked. And the police, whose job it was to dig up the evidence Davis had to produce, came up so short on the case that the two top officers on the London force would eventually resign in disgrace. Of the police, you say, like a shy bride on her honeymoon, the police disclosed just a little of what they had.
Yeah.
They clearly didn't want to investigate this case thoroughly. Some have since been convicted for taking News International money, call it bribery, mm-hmm. call it being on a retainer, what have you. How much did the payments, the passing of money, have mm-hmm. to do with the police's reluctance to investigate versus their fear of News International's investigative powers, because nobody would have a better idea mm-hmm. of the power of those investigations okay. than people who investigate other people for a living?
Okay, so if you look at the failure of the police, you are not looking at the impact of bribes. That was something that went on quite a lot, but with low-level officers who happened to have a bit of information about a celebrity. When you look at the failure in senior ranks at Scotland Yard to investigate the phone hacking scandal...
Failure, I think you're cutting them some slack. Refusal is
okay.
the word.
What, yeah? What you're looking at quite often in this sequence of events is a desire not to get into a nasty fight with this very, very powerful news organisation. And if you look at that fear, it's the same where government is concerned as where police is concerned. Part of it is individual fear that this newspaper might come in and expose the sex lives of the senior officers. And then, apart from that, there's an organisational fear that if these newspapers turn against us, they can make every day a crisis. They can just destabilise us. And you put those two together, the individual fear and the organisational fear. And it generates what I call in the book a passive power, that Rupert Murdoch and his people don't have to say to the police, back off or else we'll hurt you. The police have already got the message. Let's just not get into a fight with these people. And so, effectively, they become above the law, which is really quite a serious problem.
You write that when asked what they did for a living, some tabloid reporters would say, we destroy lives. The term you use in the book is they monster people. They would expose whatever scandal, use whatever scandalous means possible to expose someone, an adulterer, to out a homosexual from the closet. But there are tabloid newspapers all over the world. What is it about the tabloid culture in the UK that makes it so much worse than just about anywhere else?
It's to do with geography and railway lines, which is that you've got a very small country here and something like 60 million people stuffed into it. And ever since the Industrial Revolution, when we built the railway network, you've been able to reach all of these 60 million people with an overnight train from London or Glasgow. And so you could reach them and sell them newspapers. Now that's an extremely big competitive market compared to most other countries. You compare it to the United States. You put a newspaper on a train at midnight in New York and head it westwards. By 5 o'clock in the morning, it's in the middle of nowhere. So you don't have that national market, or at least not until the electronic revolution. Once you've got all these national newspapers competing for all those readers, it means that they become much more ruthless in their quest for the story. And that in turn means they become much more cruel. So they will set themselves no boundaries in the stuff that they're prepared to do to get their story and the things that they're prepared to say about the people they're writing about. They'll go right into your bedroom and say exactly what you're doing sexually if that's going to sell them newspapers.
For years, you were the lone voice in the wilderness on this story. Other media in the UK did not want to know about what you were reporting about. Were they as fearful of making enemies in News International as the police and the parliamentarians were? Is that what stopped them from doing the story?
Okay, so the refusal of most other news organisations to get involved in uncovering the scandal was for different reasons. So in the first place, too many of those news organisations are owned by Rupert Murdoch, so they're not about to expose their sister
40%
newspaper.
Of the newspaper market here effectively controlled by Murdoch.
Okay. Then beyond that, other newspapers were themselves engaged in similar criminal activity.
Not on the same scale.
I would say there were other newspaper groups which were worse and which have not yet been exposed.
Really?
But they had every reason to avoid bringing the story out. And then beyond that, there was a political dimension to it, that the guy who was the editor of the News of the World when this was going on, Andy Coulson, had gone to work for the leader of the Conservative Party, and the Conservative supporting newspapers didn't want to embarrass Cameron. So you've got a multiplicity of reasons.
You needed friends in the media. You went offshore to find them.
Yeah.
You went to the New York Times, handed over a big chunk of your research. Mm-hmm. No journalist likes to do that. But you wanted to keep some company. How important was the piece that the New York Times did? And was it the journalism that they did? Mm-hmm. Or was it the fact that they were essentially saying the same thing as you were under a different masthead?
In this whole saga, The Guardian, I think we would have dropped this story at various points on the way through, because it's a good story and we'd given it a good bang, but maybe time to move on to something else. But we couldn't, because the other side were attacking us and questioning our credibility. And it was with that in mind, I think, as much as anything else, that we did a very strange thing. My editor going to the editor of the New York Times and saying, here's a good story, giving it away. And then New York Times reporters came to London. I spent hours and hours and hours briefing them. They went and spent weeks, months following it up and did a great job. It wasn't a conventional journalistic approach. We were having to protect ourselves as well as tell the story.
Plus, a lot of people in the UK were saying, well, this is just The Guardian, a lefty paper going mm-hmm. on and on about a right-wing, ideologically different newspaper, news organization, whereas the New York Times was seen to be somewhat above the fray. The irony being, the New York Times mm-hmm. is in a fight to the death in New York City against the Wall Street Journal, which is also owned by Murdoch.
So I think it's probably fair to say that in asking ourselves, well, to which newspaper should we try and offer this story, it was clear that the New York Times might be more interested in it than others because they were precisely under attack from Murdoch's Wall Street Journal. And plus, it's a great story. You've got the royal family, private investigators, tabloid journalists doing crazy things. So it was good chemistry to get them involved, and they went for it.
The New York Times didn't just report the story. It put three journalists on it, two of them winners of the Pulitzer Prize, and attacked it. The Times unearthed a key source Nick Davis hadn't got to, and reinforced The Guardian's contention that News International's one rogue reporter defense was proving ludicrous. The Times published in September of 2010, just as the story was reaching a critical stage politically. 4 months prior to that, Prime Minister David Cameron's Conservatives took power, and Cameron brought a key Murdoch player with him to 10 Downing Street, Andy Coulson, as his communications chief. Coulson was the former editor of the News of the World, and had resigned in the early stages of the scandal, taking responsibility for it, he said, although he maintained he did not know it was happening at the time. But as the stories and the apparent scale of the hacking kept coming, Coulson's position at the top of British politics became untenable. And 5 months after the New York Times published its story on phone hacking, Coulson resigned from number 10. The Cameron government was now stained. Still, the police continued to look the other way, and the newspaper industry's self-regulatory body, the Press Complaints Commission, was proving itself wholly unfit for purpose. Rather than sanctioning Murdoch's News International for its criminal practices, the PCC had criticized the journalism of The Guardian in exposing that. Finally, in July 2011, the breakthrough.
Tonight, this program has new revelations.
Stories that had nothing to do with the hacking of the rich and famous. Murdoch's tabloid reporters had also invaded the phones of grieving military families who had lost loved ones in Afghanistan, and the families of those killed in the 7/7 bombings in London, as well as, in the most infamous case of all, Millie Dowler, a teenage girl who had gone missing and would later be found murdered. When that Dowler story went to print on July 5th, 2011, Britons reacted with revulsion, and no one, not Parliament, not the police, not the PCC, nor the other news organizations in Britain, could ignore it any longer. 5 days later, News Corp shut down the News of the World. 3 days after that, the company dropped its bid to buy out Britain's most profitable broadcaster, BSkyB. All of it triggered by the Dowler story. You said in the book that when you sent the story in to Rusbridger, your editor, you said, I think this might be the big one.
Yes, and it's because of the emotional impact of the Millie Dowler story and the families of people who had been killed in the terrorist bombs in London in 2005 had been hacked. The families of British soldiers killed in Afghanistan had been hacked. And those two stories hit an emotional level. They produce a revulsion. And even if you previous to that point, you might sit back and say, ah, well, it's only politicians and film stars and they're public figures, they've got thick skins. And finally you cross the line. And one of the crucial things was that the Millie Dowler story crossed the line emotionally, forced other newspapers to come in and report the thing. and they in turn brought other emotionally very powerful stories in. So you started to get a chain reaction at last.
You went further than a lot of journalists might mm-hmm. on this story. When Mark Lewis, who was one of the lawyers involved, told you that he wanted to take some legal steps on behalf of certain parties, but he couldn't afford the legal costs, mm-hmm. you got in touch with Max Mosley, ex-Formula One figure, tabloid casualty. Mm-hmm. He had a huge axe to grind with News International. And you asked him whether he would pay for some of these mm-hmm. legal actions and get some of these cases going. He stepped up and said that he would, because he is personally a very wealthy man.
Yeah.
Do you have any hesitation in doing that?
No, so it is definitely unusual that I was intervening in events in order to make things happen, which would then lead to the disclosure of information, which I could then report. And the thing that made me feel okay about doing this was that I borrowed it from the memoirs of Sir Harry Evans, who is not only probably the most successful British newspaper editor since the war, but also the most respected for his awareness of ethics. And in his memoirs, he describes how he did a very similar thing where he got his reporters to persuade some people to sue so that they could go to court. The court would order disclosure of material, which they could then use to run their stories. So I thought to myself, if it's good enough for Harry Evans, it's certainly good enough for me. And so I set out as a tactical move to trace people who I knew had been the victims of hacking, because I was talking to people who'd worked for the News of the World, to try to persuade them to sue, to then hook them up with the lawyers who were becoming expert in suing over the hacking in order to bring their cases to court so that the judge would then order disclosure of information and I could stick it in the newspaper.
And there was much more evidence to come. Under enormous pressure, given his links to the Murdoch Empire through Andy Coulson, Prime Minister Cameron ordered a judicial inquiry into the relationship between the press and politics in Britain. They were all called in to testify before the judge. The phone hackers, their editors, the news barons, including two generations of Murdochs, and the politicians who had curried their favor. And then came the trial that would form the final chapter in Nick Davies' book. It started with a piece of irony that some found delicious. The prosecution revealed that Andy Coulson and his former boss, Rebecca Brooks, who oversaw the destruction of so many reputations through their tawdry journalism, had their own reputation soiled when the prosecution revealed that the two had had an extramarital affair of their very own. Despite a sizable and expensive legal team, Coulson was convicted and sentenced to jail. Rebecca Brooks, however, was acquitted.
And I feel vindicated by the unanimous verdicts.
You wrote, paraphrasing now, of the trials of Rebecca Brooks and Andy Coulson, that nowhere was the power of News Corp more evident than in that courtroom. Mm-hmm. That its corporate muscle, its money, was on display in the resources, mm-hmm. the barristers, the solicitors, the researchers, that they completely dwarfed the resources mm-hmm. of the state, the prosecution. Given all of that, were the verdicts a foregone conclusion for you?
Okay, so I've been covering courts in London for 35 years, and certainly I have never seen a defense as well-funded or as well-equipped as those that were on display in the big phone hacking trial for Rebecca Brooks and Andy Coulson. And against that, it was like a microcosm of the way the world is, the power of corporations and the weakness of the state. The Crown Prosecution Service is like any part of the British public sector now. It's underfunded. It was hopelessly outgunned. So that was certainly an important factor in the trial. I personally don't think that that entitles us to say that the people who were found not guilty should have been found guilty. There were all sorts of other factors in there as well. So people are particularly interested in Rebecca Brooks. They say, surely she was guilty. Surely she should have been convicted. And the reality is the evidence wasn't there to justify it. So the most that the prosecutors could ever say was, she must have known. And she must have known isn't good enough. If you're going to send somebody to prison, it has to be, you have to be sure. You have to know beyond reasonable doubt.
But on the US and Murdoch, there is still a legal case ongoing there under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And I can remember back just at the heyday of the story mm-hmm. a couple of years ago, there was a belief stated on the part of some legal experts that there was actually more statutory equipment and in the US than in the UK, and that they could do more damage there, that Murdoch could end up suffering more serious legal consequences in the US than here in the UK. What do you think the prospects are of that a couple of years later?
So American law presents a particular threat to Murdoch's global parent company, News Corp, the part that now owns newspapers, which isn't there really in the United Kingdom. That's because the Americans have this law called the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which makes it an offence for an American company to employ anybody anywhere in the world who pays a bribe to a public official. So what's about to happen in London is you've got a sequence of trials due to take place of Murdoch reporters who are accused of paying bribes to public officials. Now, we don't know what the outcome of these trials will be. If some or any or all of them are convicted of paying bribes, that will trigger the FBI inquiry in the United States under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, and it may well be that you can see the parent company News Corp being prosecuted, which would be very, very damaging for Rupert Murdoch. But that law doesn't really apply here in the UK.
Going back to your epilogue now, where you say that actually very little has changed with News Corp and journalism. Here's what I would suggest has changed. The Murdoch family dynasty at News Corporation is done. The succession plan for James Murdoch to inherit his father's chair is history. And as you put it in the book, he's a dead man presiding over meetings in New York that don't really matter. Two, there's still some ugly journalism in the UK. It will continue, but nothing like what was happening or on the scale that it was happening before. Three, news of the world is history. There is a Sun on Sunday, but the circulation figures about a million fewer readers than the news of the world happened. Then there are the things that didn't happen. Murdoch wanted to buy B Sky B, Britain's most profitable broadcaster. He wanted to buy the 61% of B Sky B that he didn't already own. Your work forced them to drop that bid. And perhaps most importantly, and people don't talk about this, Ofcom, the British broadcast regulator, the Murdochs wanted that abolished. David Cameron vowed that he would abolish Ofcom. Had he abolished Ofcom, then we would have the same kind of regulations perhaps as they have in the United States. Murdoch would have been able to turn Sky News Television into Fox News UK. So when you add all that up, perhaps your pessimism is a little bit misguided, and your modesty too.
Okay, well, if we just look at the part about how the Murdochs have been doing since. The dynasty, particularly Lachlan and James, the two sons, appears to be trying to re-establish its position within the company, and people who know more about it than I do say that actually those two lads are better placed than they were, say, 12 months ago to take over. Bigger than that, the profits for the corporation keep rising, the individual incomes of the Murdochs keeps rising to crazy levels, and beyond that, you will have noticed that a month or two ago, they bid to take over Time Warner. And beneath that, what I'm saying is, it isn't really about one individual man and how he does. It's about the structures of power. It's about living in a society in which we allow one man to become so rich and so powerful. So that even if Murdoch turns around tomorrow morning and says, enough, I quit, it doesn't make any difference. I sell my newspapers, it doesn't make any difference. Some Middle Eastern billionaire will move in, or some Russian oligarch. And they'll buy those newspapers, and they will have exactly the same amount of power that Murdoch did. We haven't changed the structures, is the point I'm really making. And they are structures which tend to be very damaging for the rest of us who are not part of the power elite, for the rest of us who still like that idea about democracy or don't quite understand why some people should be grotesquely rich while other people are starving. Nothing's changed in that respect with the big, big stuff.
Final question. How's the screenplay coming along?
There isn't a screenplay.
Why is there no screenplay?
I don't know. It would be nice if there was a screenplay. I agree. And
you could shop at the 20th Century Fox.
I know.
Murdoch Studio.
That's actually, because this is the book that I've written has been published in lots of different countries where there are lots of different Murdoch newspapers. But curiously enough, not one Murdoch newspaper has run a single review of the book. Isn't that depressing? Isn't that surprising?
Nick Davis, good work. It's a fine book. Congratulations on a big chunk of your life and what you were able to accomplish. And thanks for talking to us here at the Listening Post. Here's the postscript. You'll have noticed that Nick Davis, when I asked him, how's the screenplay coming along, chose his words carefully. He said there isn't a screenplay. Then he changed the subject. The day after we recorded that interview, news came out that there will be a movie version of Davis's book to be directed by George Clooney. Shooting is scheduled to start next year. So there may well not be a screenplay yet, but there's clearly one coming. And in that respect, the truth, the whole truth, has just caught up with Nick Davis. We'll see you next time here at the Listening Post.